So if you've been around the Reolink world, you've probably seen this camera.
You got the nail on you.
And yeah, it looks the same, but this is the Reolink Duo 3. And yeah, is that the Reolink 2, 3 if you break it down? This is their third revision of this. I've messed around with the previous ones. This is a 16 megapixel camera. I guess it's 2 8 megapixels squished together in a 180 degree. Now they have not changed the case. And this is just my little board that I use for my little test setup. I wanted to talk about some of the things before we got into the actual technical side of things, which that leads me to, if you want to skip around, there are chapters down below. Like, we're going to get into like Frigate and BI, and you may not give a crap about that, or the NVR, whatever it may be. You just want to skip on to the ending conclusion, then go right ahead. Now, of course, you'll find all the links down below to pick one up. Reolink did send this for review, but of course, no additional funds were exchanged as always, so it definitely keeps it unbiased, and yeah, you'll really find that here. So, the one thing I didn't really like was the mount. They didn't change the mount up. It's meant for a wall mount, but then if you look here, is the wire comes so close to the wall. And really what I prefer, if you don't have a wall to mount it to, is pick up one of these, because why pick up one of these? Because there is a mounting hole on the top. And if you're mounting it on the eave, you could take it and screw this to the top of the actual camera itself. And then you wouldn't have this bracket on the bottom here. You would just have this hanging from an eave. Now, this is the wall mount. This doesn't come with this. You'll have to find these wherever. I got them off of Amazon for super cheap. I think when I was messing around with some Wyze cameras or something like that. The mount, they just have this plate you stick on the wall. Well, then this camera comes and just clips in. And you can imagine this is your wall here, but what about weatherproofing? If I want to run the wire through here, I don't know, it's a whole weird design. If you haven't seen it before, it's going to be two lenses. There's one lens here, one over here. There's the IR around the rings here. There's also white lights to give it so you can do some night color. Now there is, I believe, a speaker here for you can set off an alarm. I think it has two-way talk. I'd have to check. I think it does. It does record audio. This is the PoE version. Now, they also, in the 2 model, they have one with floodlights on the side. Hopefully, they'll do that in the 3 as well.
I can't even realize it before I run.
Come on.
Currently, the recording of this video, there's not available, but I'm probably sure by the time I get to edit and everything and put this up, this will all change. If not, just look down for the links below and maybe they'll put it up shortly. Now, to compare, it looks like they're going for like 190 for the Duo 3. The Duo 2 is going for 115. Here nor there, whether it's worth the additional cost, the 16 megapixel versus, what is that one? I guess 8 megapixel. But you can see they look fairly similar in looks. So one thing I wanted to look at was, did they actually change the actual sensor? I wanted to look down at the specs. And here's the specs here. This is the Duo 3. Is a 2.7. 1 over 2.7. And looks like 1 over 2.7 on the Duo 2. So, I will just go here with it. I got a lot of video clips of showing like night vision, color night vision, with the LEDs, without, etc. Definitely run the lights. I'll tell you that right now. Don't try to run it with no lights at all. It's not like, you know, their color night vision, the CX400, or I think that's what the model number is. It's not going to be like that. They are using H265 on the substream. I don't see any way to change that. And it does make sense because it is a 16 megapixel stream. And yeah, just that's probably too much for H264 to really these processors and these cameras to handle. So it does support micro SD card if you want to record to that. There it is, built-in microphone and speaker. They've changed their page up a little bit here. Does have the person and vehicle detection stuff with the lighting. That's pretty cool. Software-wise, here it is. It does support RTSP and RTMP. I know Frigate users are probably looking for that. And same thing for BI users. You do need to make sure to go enable it in the networking stuff. That's like defaulted to being disabled now. Now I'm using the Reolink PC app. I'm assuming it'd be the same for Mac OS. They have an awesome Android app. I'm assuming it's the same on iOS. They're really great apps for being able to navigate around, simple for all the users. And it's kind of why I love their setups. Is their apps are pretty cool that you don't have to do any like punching through firewalls or whatever. You just plug it into the network and boom, it works when you're not at home as long as you have remote access turned on. So for the camera setup, you do get, of course, the microphone. There you can do time lapse. I hadn't played with that a whole lot. There's the audio alarm. You can turn the lights on and off. And you can see, I just had this pointing towards the wall. And this is just if you want to manually turn stuff on and off. There's the black and white mode. I guess it turned on the infrared lights just based on the amount of lighting. In the actual setup, you want to geek off into here. You can go turn off the stupid watermark. I have OCD on that one where it puts the branding on it. The stream, they do have all the stuff you can change for the stream stuff. I know a lot of BI Frigate users will want to dig off into here. But like I said before, do keep in mind, this is H265. I didn't see a way to change that. Now, one thing I wanted to bring up, which I'll show an example, they have this motion mark, which is beta, which is pretty cool. I like being able to see that. It puts a square over the motion. All the settings in here are nuts for like this object size, for like the vehicle, the person, the animals. You got the lights, the infrared light, spotlight, audio. It's all in here. It's fairly easy to dig off into and mess with. And a lot of this is available in the NVR and the actual like the Android app and probably the iOS app as well. So you really don't need to be in either or places to view things. Now, I did record to the micro SD card. So if you want to dig off into here, let's see, on the 13th, we did some stuff and we'll play here. Yeah, those are the amount of bugs and everything that are running around because the lights are on. So that is one thing that whenever you do turn the lights on, they're fairly bright and it's all works over power over Ethernet. But this is that motion mark where it puts the motion on there because a lot of times previous cameras, you didn't know what triggered it as motion. They're like, what was over there? What was it seeing that as a person? Then you could go fix that or block that out. And it's marking these over here as because those are seeing those as vehicles, I assume, because I sometimes will see one over here, another one over here during daylight. The other feature I wanted to show was the motion mark. This is what really caught my eye at CES when they did this. Now, I wish they would expand upon this. So Reolink, if you're watching, stop digging this just into email notifications. We need to be able to put this and view this in several other places as well, especially if you're gonna bring it to other cameras. That was the limitation I found about this, was you had to go through and set up email notifications. It only sends you this picture during emails. Well, with SMTP and security settings, and not all ISPs are running SMTP anymore, and it becomes, yeah, a PITA for somebody. And if you don't know what PITA is, you can go look it up, P-I-T-A. It's difficult to go through and set up this SMTP. I wish you would just send this like in a push notification of this snapshot, and then you could just pull it up using the app. That'd be pretty slick. They definitely need to fix that. But it's pretty neat. You can be able to see where everything happened during the entire motion event, and it puts a time above. You can actually see when we were over here, and you can follow us kind of out there, all the different kids. No, I don't have this many kids. I have one OG, and that is enough. And you can see then we walked over here based on the times. Pretty damn slick the way this motion track works, and it stitches all those, you know, like images together. One thing I did forget, one of my favorite features, if you go to light and go into spotlight, and you can set the spotlights to only turn on when there's a person, vehicle, or even animal. And I turned off vehicle because I had it facing the road. I didn't want it turning on every time a car passed. It'd turn on every 5 minutes. That's pretty damn slick that the lights only turn on when someone walks by and records, you know, in full brightness. That way you can see what's going on or whatever. And you can even change how bright the lights are. That's pretty damn cool. I wish some of the other cameras had that as well, like the Dawa ones. Now, my recommendation always for Reolink cameras, and I know I kind of nagged them at CES for this a bit, is use the Reolink cameras with a Reolink NVR. It is really where they want you to be in their like ecosystem of things. They work okay with Blue Iris, BI, whatever, or Frigate, or other software NVRs. But then you got to run it through like GoToRTC, and then you got to do this stuff, and it becomes a pain. And you spend a lot of time trying to get it to work with Blue Iris and Frigate. I wish they would really have their codecs work better. If they would want to make more sales, I don't know. Maybe they don't. But if you're going to be using Frigate, going to be using BI, you do need to come off into here and go into the server settings, and you need to turn on the services that you want, because by default, all this stuff is off. And then you'll be trying to set stuff up and it's not going to work, and you'll be beating your head against the wall and saying these docs and this thing on this forum don't work and Digi was wrong. But yeah, it just go in there and go set this stuff up and go play around with all the different settings and everything. Now, this is the setting it to have if you want to be able to view it in the app remotely. Now, while it does work with Frigate, you can see I've got it here, and it does work fine. I did have to play around a little bit and have it just, you know, pick up the record, the 16 megapixel, just direct. GoToRTC link was not working for some reason, and I just skipped it, and then I used GoToRTC to pick up the actual substream, and it seemed to work fine. Don't get any errors in the log. And I can go through here and pick up the people, and yeah, it plays all the snapshots, and it seems to be fairly smooth. Yeah, I don't mind the weirdo chasing the one chicken out in the yard. But yeah, so it's fairly okay. I mean, it does work with Frigate. It did pick up all the people and everything. I guess it's saying that there was a person here, but I guess that's more of a Frigate thing. I don't really have this tuned for like the percentages and everything. If you're looking for the Frigate settings, I've pretty much followed the docs for the actual other Reolink cameras as well, but I can share some stuff, or you can hit me up in Discord if you have this in Frigate and can't get it going. Now in Blue Iris, it does work for the most part. You may have to tweak a few settings and everything with it. It is H.265, so make sure your processor GPU definitely supports it, because they're going to get quite hungry with that 16 megapixel stream. Now, the substream is 624, so it may not be as bad for like motion detection. But do make sure that if you're exporting anything, it's all going to be 265, so that make sure whatever you're viewing supports that for like your archives or whatever you're doing with the video. Now, I know this is quite small, but I do have my Blue Iris running in 4K on my living room TV and can get it around all the TVs in the house with the matrix switch. Maybe that'll be another video one day. But it really just came in here and I hit configure and then hit find inspect and put in the user and the password and then pick the mainstream and the substream. Really didn't need to do a whole lot else. Kept things kind of static and it just worked for the most part. Now you may have to mess with some of the frame rate settings and everything to kind of get the best fluid frame rate, because there's like, you know, the CBR versus VBR. If you play with Blue Iris, you know what I'm talking about. And all those stuff is in the stream settings on the camera. Luckily, they do expose most of those for the most part, but not as good as you see with the DAWA-based stuff. So it does work with Blue Iris. Sometimes I did notice it would get the little yellow triangle on here saying there was an error with it, but it did record most of the things. So there's that. So that leads us, should you buy one? Keep in mind right now, the target price on their website without any discounts is $190. If you're got a Reolink NVR and you're looking for something and you want it really stupid high resolution, and yeah, then go ahead. Yeah, maybe just the Duo 2 might be good enough for you. It's not a massive change in resolution because... I know you're thinking, well, it's 8 megapixel versus 16 megapixel. It's going to be twice as good, right? That's not exactly how that works, unfortunately. It's going to be a little bit better, but nothing crazy. Now, of course, the camera looks the same, works the same. They do have that motion tracked. And, yeah, it's if you've seen the Duo 2, then you've probably seen most of what you've seen here. Is like, what's different, Travis? Why, is there anything to be excited about? Not really. I mean, I really wasn't like crazy excited except for maybe seeing that motion track. But I want to see that get expanded into something further and not just buried off in some email of motion track that you have to go set up. So all in all, it's a pretty decent camera. I just wish they would have changed the mount up a little bit in this third revision. Maybe fourth time is a charm. So... I do appreciate you watching, all the YouTube members and Patreon subscribers, and thanks to Reolink for having me at their booth and letting me check out this new product. And yep, y'all know the drill. Press all them buttons and y'all take care.
Wait for it.